centers of the other stars and galaxies and planets. Everything has a center, and they all vibrate. And that's what creates the sound in the universe, as a matter of fact. Hmm. But back to the first dimension for a minute, it turns out scientifically that the first dimension vibrates at about 60 hertz, which is 60 pulses per second, 40 to 60 pulses per second. Now, it turns out that 40 to 60 hertz is beta frequency in our brain. And when we're on beta frequency, our brains are synchronized, and we basically have access to anything in the universe. And so when we synchronize with that frequency in that core, we can read the Akashic records. And so it's not an airy-fairy idea, if you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
And I just
mm-hmm.
taught at the Edgar Cayce Institute a couple of weeks ago, and, of course, Cayce just had fabulous access to the Akashic records. And
mm-hmm.
so I think something happens for us. This book, I think, creates a grounding for a whole lot of information that was kind of flying around
yes.
the ethers until now, you know?
Yes, absolutely. And then it made so much sense that coming up through those energies coming up pass through the second dimension, which is the telluric, where the it interfaces with the third, and that's kind of the an element of, well, isn't that where the elementals and the fairies and the divas and our suppressed shadow resides?
Yeah, and microbes and viruses, all that.
Right, right.
Yeah, right.
And then we have the level of the fourth, which is like the canopy that you show in your book in the various diagrams, which is one of those diagrams is worth the whole book.
I know that one diagram. When Gary and I teach, sometimes we teach with only one. We just, unlike all these people who do PowerPoint, we just stand
yes.
up there with that one diagram and go to work on it because it's really fabulous.
Oh, it is. That is such a powerful tool.
And, you know, it shows how we receive the dimensions. In other words, the issue would be, okay, all these dimensions are out there, but how do you connect with them? And that's what's great about that illustration.
Yes. Now, the other question that goes along with connecting to them is why we're so disconnected, and what happens, you know, how does that happen that these higher dimensions are mainly inaccessible to most people, or have been? What's breaking up that energy, and how does that involve the control paradigms that have been actively attempting to lasso humanity
yeah.
into kind of a vicious cycle?
Well, there's kind of two theories running through this material. One of them has to do with the fact that there was a gigantic cataclysm in our solar system around 11, 12, 13,000 years ago. And that is, of course, described in this book, the story of what actually happened. And then what happened with that cataclysm, there's kind of two ways to look at it. First of all, it basically really screwed us up electromagnetically, and it screwed up our ability to receive higher states of consciousness. And so we began to devolve at that point instead of continue to develop on the line that we were on. Then the other thing that happened when this event occurred on our planet is that some people were stronger than other people, and the whole process of powerful people controlling weak people went into gear. And then once that happened, it built and it built and it built until now we are living on a planet where we have an elite or a world management team that is basically running everything. Very few people are running things on the planet in a way that most people disagree with violently.
Mm-hmm.
And so what the world management team did, if you think about that diagram of the person on the table in the third dimension and then
mm-hmm.
a canopy over their body, the
mm-hmm.
world management team realized early on, 5,000 years ago, if they could cut individuals off from direct access to those higher dimensions, then
yes.
people would not be able to develop and grow and go in the direction that they wanted to go in. So the world management team has very successfully been reducing people to basically what I call the Oreo cookie. We've been reduced to the second, third, and fourth dimension. And
yep.
it would be like we're in the third dimension in linear space and time, and we're like the white sugar inside the Oreo cookie. And then the second and the fourth dimension are squeezing us in.
Yes.
And the World Management Team managed to do that by creating religions, especially the main Western religions. And the religions are like Christianity and Judaism and Islam. These religions are functioning in the fourth dimension as a control paradigm, and it's keeping people from having the direct access that they're capable of.
Yes, boy, well said. Now, would that relate to how would that relate to the difference between a negative and a positive polarity, and how that's managed to translate as duality versus polarity?
Yeah, that's a really complex issue. And the way we work with that when we're teaching is we use a healing model. So I'll do that in just a moment. But first of all, what happens in the fourth dimension is that things split into positive and negative, dark and light, good and evil. They split into all of those levels and or those dualities.
Mm-hmm.
And when I found out about that from the Pleiadians, I had a whole lot of questions about why that was the case. And I finally came to the conclusion that it's just basic science, because when you're in the third dimension, now another interesting thing about this material is the Pleiadians say each dimension has a science. And so what they say is they say Newtonian physics works in the third dimension. It's the science of the third dimension. And then when we get into the fourth dimension, we get into fourth and fifth dimension, we get into quantum realities. And so they're saying that, and as you know in the book, each level of science is identified. But regarding the issue of duality, if we look at third dimension and we look at Newtonian science, basically electromagnetism is all based on positive and negative energy. So I think it's just a function of the way electromagnetism functions in the third dimension. I think that's why it works that way. But the trick is that for us as humans, and this is where we humans differ from plants and animals, because in many cases I think plants and animals are actually superior to us. And so when I bring these things up, I'm not talking about who's better. You know, like I think cats are very six-dimensional, all that stuff.
Yeah.
But regarding being a human, our task as a human really is to master the fourth dimension and to learn how to experience everything in life as a polarity and not a duality. And what that means is with any given emotional experience that we have or emotional relationship that we have, we need to develop it to such a degree that it's not about dark and light and positive and negative. It's all about being centered and having a very, very wide polarity on an issue. So when we teach that stuff, we use the healing session as an example in workshops, because when you go to a healing session, basically what you're really doing is you're resolving those dualities and preparing yourself to be able to go into higher dimensions.
Now that probably involves, I'm familiar with healing, a lot of healers through the show, and that involves a lot of processing and unblocking and letting go.
That's right.
So the basically what the healer is doing is empowering the individual to be free.
Yeah, that's right. And they're also holding space for the person so that the person can do the work, because I'm glad you talked to healers, so I'll take a minute on this. What a healer is doing is they're slowing the frequency of the person on the table down to the second dimension, because the second dimension is where you have all the elemental information about your health and your emotions.
Mm-hmm.
But the healer also, even though they don't usually, or I shouldn't say don't, but frequently, see, healers are trained really well, but they often don't really know what's going on as far as...
Right, right.
And so the healer, meanwhile, has had a little discussion with the person, and they want to know, like they want some kind of cue, because when you go for a healing session, you've gone for a specific reason. And so the healer, while they get it together with the client, what they're doing is they're tuning into the first dimension, and they're tuning into those Akashic records.
Yeah.
And then finally, the healer gains confidence that they understand and can feel what the person really needs. And then they help the person go into whatever the issue is, whatever the block is. And, of course, there's many, many techniques for doing that.
Right.
But once the healer and the client start working on the block itself, then what happens is that polarity starts to open on the issue, and then people can travel into very, very high dimensions. So that's why the Pleiadians show that diagram as a person on a table.
Yeah, that's so powerful. I just, I'm going to be referring to that constantly.
Yeah. Well, when it came through, by the way, the Pleiadians are really difficult to deal with because they're very demanding.
Yeah.
I mean, look at my life, you know. And so, I've had a big job description. And so when that diagram came in, and all of the diagrams, is what the Pleiadians do is they tell me to get out a piece of paper and a pencil. And then they transmit an image onto the page, and all I do is draw it. And then it's up to me after that to figure out what the whole thing means. And so it took me a number of years to figure out why, because, see, that could also be a person sitting in a chair or a person walking around.
Right.
It could be any, you could be in any position in the third dimension. But the point is that most of us experience these kinds of levels in healing sessions.
Yes, yes. Now, how does that relate to, I guess what I'm trying to ask is, where does the collective consciousness reside? Is that in the level of the archetypes at the fourth?
Yeah, the collective mind, collective consciousness. The fourth dimension is the location of the all of the thoughts and feelings of the human race. And that's why it's important to keep, you know, like your dog when you're sitting in the sun relaxing in the morning isn't worried about the war in Iraq, you know.
But, right.
But, you know, but we're all plugged into this collective, which has negative aspects, which we all know because a lot of people, see, we're supposed to live in 3D. And it's linear space and time, and we're supposed to be here oriented toward the directions and in touch with the second dimension, the first dimension. But a lot of people are out of their bodies and they're floating around in the fourth dimension. And the problem with that is, and also people who watch television all the time or people who tune into the media all the time, because if you let your consciousness be in the collective too much of the time, then what starts to happen is you're not really in your body. So that's the negative side of the fourth dimension. But the positive side of the fourth dimension is that we're all plugged into it. Even if you don't watch TV, and even if you're a indigenous person living on the Andaman Islands, there's still a way in which all of the human race is part of this collective mind. Like, for example, Aboriginal or indigenous people are dreamers. And even if they know anything about the news, they know everything about what's going on, I can assure you. Like they laugh when they see us using telephones or cell phones, because they don't need that stuff. They can do this with their consciousness.
Oh, right.
So the advantage of this plug-in is that we're on the verge now, next year, according to Kalaman, of going into the ninth underworld of the Mayan calendar. This is called the Universal Underworld. And when we move into the Universal Underworld, this collective plug-in is going to become very, very powerful for our species. And we're going to start experiencing a true oneness and a true connection with all of us, and not we're moving very rapidly now out of that separation.
Yes. Now it seems that there's a lot of meme engineering going on from that dimension, and that is part of what has been keeping us from connecting at those levels where because when we meet people in the streets, sometimes there's such synchronicity that it seems that we're just gravitating towards the right person, and we're communicating at a telepathic level, even though what we're saying to each other might be seem like a mundane conversation. It's almost like we're actors on a stage, and we're actually connecting at a higher level. But we're going to get, if Kalaman and you are correct in the timing, then we're headed towards a time when we will be conscious of this connection.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting the way you put that, Lance. You just said something I've never really thought of before. I never really thought about what goes on, you know, when you run into somebody on the street and there's just that kind of connection. And I think probably that happens with people when they're really, really fully in the third dimension. And then they're really activated by the first and second dimension. And so their body is almost like kind of radiating a kind of intelligence that makes it possible to connect at that collective level. You know,
it's
the way you put that.
Oh, well, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you. Well, you know, it just seems so much more practical. And from what I've learned, you know, over the, you know, just from listening to people like you and paying attention, is that we're all moving into that space. And nobody is really left out unless they just are, it's just timing differences.
Yeah. And speaking, another thing the Pleiades